find a spot and get started here. Welcome everybody out this evening. Don't forget, we've got all kinds of snacks and finger food back there for afterwards. Probably got a little bit left from last night, and I seen a whole lot more come in. So please be sure and hang around and visit with us and have some snacks. Appreciate everybody coming back out. A lot of you I see from last night. I've got a few new faces, and I'll just welcome you. These folks are longtime friends of mine. They don't like me to say that in public, but I done messed it up now. But they do a real good job. And as bad as I aggravate them, I really do just love them as friends. And brothers and sisters in the Lord, that's the people that I've got to know through the years, and I don't ever want to be too sappy. That's not exactly my style, but they are they're good folks, and they're here to bless you, and hopefully you'll be blessed. Do we have any prayer requests to start off? Okay, remember Scooter. Yep. Once again, let's remember the peace in Israel and in Jerusalem. Okay. Yep. Oakland's got to find out some more stuff about her tests next Friday. So. Anybody else? Everybody's being real quiet. I bet we have a lot of unspoken requests, though. Amen. Okay. Always remember our unsaved friends, loved ones, co-workers. We live in a lost and dying world. We really do. But we are a remnant. We're the reason why the Lord hasn't already given up on America. People who really do believe His word. People that really do believe He is the way, the truth, and the life. No man comes to the Father but by Him. Those are His words, not mine. So,
and I think this church and all the prayer warriors, I came a long way since March.
Amen.
I had that last treatment, and my legs just floated out from underneath me, and I didn't know what it was, and it was rotten. But I'm up and walking, and my leg has got feeling in it, and thank God for all of these. I love you to death.
Amen. God still answers prayer, don't He?
Yes.
Sure does. If I didn't think He did, why would we have prayer? He still answers prayer. That's what He's always done. That's what He'll always do. He don't always answer it to suit us, though, does He?
No.
But He does answer. Let's all stand. Lord, I just want to thank You right now for this opportunity to gather together and just worship Your holy name. Lord, I just ask You to be with each and every song, each and every word, each and every prayer. Lord, I ask You just to be in this congregation. Let Your Holy Spirit just move among us, that whatever decisions need to be made, that they're the ones that are made, the ones that will suit You, not us. Lord, we ask right now that each and every prayer request we just lift up to You, and not knowing ourselves yesterday, today, and forever, knowing You do. Lord, we thank You for the fact that You do answer every prayer. I can truthfully say I don't always like the way You answer them, but I know that You answer my prayers, and I thank You for it. You know much better than I do. Help each one of us now as we move through life to realize You have the answers for us. And Lord, we just ask You once again to be with this service. In Jesus' precious name. Okay, go ahead and stay standing. I won't preach. I'm trying to think of the word I want to use. But we have a Savior, we have a King, we have a Lord, the Son of God. And you know, each and every day we get up, and me and Nick were going to do some stuff, and he sent me a message, and he said, it's going to be a good day. Well, I'm piddling around. I'm getting out of the shower. I'm thinking, well, if you'd let me sleep, Nick. But I got out and I thought, well, Nick's probably out. He knows. And so I set it down. And later on, I went and I looked out. It was a beautiful day. You was right. You was about 10 minutes early. But you was right. So what we got, folks, we've got a Savior that gives us a day. Sometimes days are tougher than others, aren't they? I ain't telling you you're going to like every day. I'm telling you He's going to be your Savior every day. Amen. He's not going to change because our circumstances change. Some days are beautiful. Some days are snowy or sleeting. But we serve a Savior. And every day when you get up, before your feet hit the ground, you ought to thank Him for that day. Amen. And thank Him for another day that's coming one day when we're going to wake up in a heaven that's always going to be a beautiful day. Amen? Amen? I'm going to turn it over to you guys. Stand up and sing with me. Some of you will know.
I wake up every morning singing this one. I want to thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. And thanks for all of the blessings that have already come my way. My cup's sure running over, and I just want to say thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. When I wake up in the morning and I stumble out of bed, my tank a minute or two to finally clear my head. But with my eyes wide open, one thing's on my mind: another day to find a way to praise Him one more time. And I want to thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. And thanks for all of the blessings that have already come my way. My cup's running over, and I just want to say thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. Well, there is no way I can repay all He's done for me. Every day to me is just an opportunity to do something good for somebody, lend a helping hand, and share the message of His word with my fellow man. And I want to thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. And thanks for all of the blessings that have already come my way. My cup's running over, and I just want to say thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day.
I want to thank You, Lord, for one more beautiful day. Thanks for all of the blessings that have already come my way. My cup's running over, and
I just want to say thank You.
This one, you sing it with us. Put your hands together just like this.
Sunlight morning when this life is o'er, I fly away to a home on God's celestial shore. I fly away. Well, now I fly away, oh glory, I fly away in the morning. Hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away on the last. Well,
just a few more weary days and then I'll fly away to a land where joy shall never end. I'll fly away. Right away in the morning when I die, hallelujah, by and by, I'll fly away.
All right, it's your turn.
When I
when I die,
when I die, I'll
all right, when I die,
when I die.
That's good singing.
That was great singing. Yeah.
That is good singing. Hey, we are glad to be back with you, and thank those of you that ask. I am feeling much better tonight than I was last night. Last night, I wasn't sure how I was going to make it through, but we made it through, and I'll tell you how bad it was. I didn't feel well, and those of you that didn't know, I didn't feel well. When I got done, I went to the car, and I let Dina drive us home. Now, she never drives us anywhere.
That's a scary thought, ain't it?
And so you know how I was feeling if I let her drive us home. But
you made it.
I know. As Brother Jim said, we made it home. And at that point, I didn't care which home I made it to. I was ready to get there. We are so thankful to be here. Hey, let's do that. Put it into God's hands, all right?
Yesterday when I came home, I was just about ready to scream. My job's been driving me crazy. I got bills that are burying me. The weight of the world was on me, and I was sinking like a storm. But then I realized that I can't make it on my own.
I'm gonna put it into God's hands. Start living on God's plan. I'm gonna do the best I can. That's all I can do. Gonna put away my doubts. Somehow it'll all work out. I can rest easy now that I put it into God's hands.
My daddy always told me you can't live by bread alone. You gotta have faith in the good Lord's grace just to keep on keeping on. Accept the things that you can't change. Change the things you can. And when you start to worry, well, just put it into God's hands.
I'm gonna put it into God's hands. Start living on God's plan. Gonna do the best I can. That's all I can do. Gonna put away my doubts. Somehow it'll all work out. I can rest easy now that I put it into God's hands.
I'm gonna put it into
God's hands. Start living on God's plan. Gonna do the best I can. That's all I can do. Gonna put away my doubts. Somehow it'll all work out. I can rest easy now that I put it into God's hands. Gonna put away my doubts. Somehow it'll all work out.
Life seems so unfair. Lord, this world is too heavy for one man to hold, and I feel like it's spinning out of control. Oh, where would I go? Who would I turn to? Tell me if I didn't have you. Who's in shelter from despair? Without you, I haven't got a prayer. You see, there have been times when everything I touched would seem like it turned to gold. Started believing that I could make it on my own. I've seen fortunes fade away and turn to dust. If there's one thing I've learned, it's in God I will trust. Where would I go? He's my shelter from despair. Without you, I haven't got a prayer. Oh, without you, Jesus,
Jesus, thank God.
I'm saved, yes. Oh, Jesus. Oh, Jesus. Do you know him today? Please don't turn him away. Oh, Jesus, my Jesus, without him, how lost I would be. Yes, without lost I would be.
I love those two songs together. I haven't got a prayer without him. It's so, so very, very true. Well, you know, we do our show in Branson 4 days a week, Monday through Thursday at 2 o'clock, and every weekend we're on the road traveling and singing. And over the last month, we've been out to Colorado. We've been to Oklahoma, been down to Arkansas last week in Kansas, this weekend here. Next weekend, we're in Pensacola, Florida. People say, why do you do what you do? Well, two reasons. One is to encourage a believer, and if you're a child of God, hope that something we say can lighten your load. Second is to introduce you to the one that we sing about. We've now done our shows now. This is our ninth season, hard to believe, in Branson. And I have learned some things that I did not know previous to that. And some of them are funny. Some of them are serious. But I had always heard, I grew up in church. I didn't grow up listening to secular music at all. But I had heard that there was this guy who was a drunk, but he wrote some good gospel songs, he wrote one that you will all know, I want you to sing it with us if you do. I had never sung this song, believe it or not, until this year, and it's similar to another song written by a guy that I know and knew that his family, Albert E. Brumley, wrote a song, and we sang it last night, called "He Set Me Free." And it's a great song in that Heavenly Highway hymn book. This song actually is similar to that. In fact, it's so similar, for the first 3 weeks we did this in the show, I messed up the words every time. So I may need your help in doing this, but this song was written by Hank Williams. And we'll see if you know it. Sing along with us on this, all right? Do that again. Waiting on me, aren't you? I wandered so aimless, life filled with sin. I wouldn't let my dear Savior in. Then Jesus came like a stranger in the night. Praise the Lord, I saw a light. I saw a light, I saw. Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Just like the blind man, I wandered along. Worries and fears I claimed as my own. And like the blind man, God gave back my sight. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
was a fool who was wandering astray. Straight is the gate and narrow the way. Now I have traded wrong for the right. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
Lift it up now.
I saw. Sorrow inside. Praise the Lord, I saw the light. Praise the Lord, I saw the light.
That was good singing. Do I?
Somebody died for me. Yeah, you guys did a great job. You know the words to that one. You bunch of heathens? No, I'm only joking. I did mess them up for about 3 weeks and everything. We want to do a song. My wife said that I preached too long last night, so we're going to do an extra song tonight. And
I don't think I said.
I think that's what she said. Of course, I wasn't feeling good, so I'm not quite sure what she said to me. But I want to do a song that Dina brought to us that we ended up putting in our show this year, and. I had forgotten about this song. It was written by a friend of ours. And in Branson, if you've ever been to Branson, you realize that in every show, we pay tribute to our veterans. And we had a spot in our show that we needed a song for. And Dina said, I want a song that has a really strong message. And I said, okay. And we looked for some songs and didn't really find the right one. And I had a conversation with my 15-year-old son that got us talking about some things, and he got us talking about sacrifices that have been made. Sacrifices that have been made in our military. We began to talk about a particular battle. One of that I absolutely love is the Battle of Shiloh over in Tennessee, and I've had the privilege of being there several times. And he said, Dad, I got to ask you about that. He said, my teacher was teaching me, and he said, he told me that Shiloh wasn't that big a deal because not too many people died there. I said, my first conversation, I said, I really need to have a conversation with this history teacher. I said, because I've walked around that battlefield, and I said, I walked around the pond they call the Bloody Pond because so many men crawled to their death there. I stood in the middle of the hornet's nest. We got to talking about sacrifices so that we can have freedom to stand and do exactly what we do. You know, we think about Israel, and, you know, God's people have lived under this for the longest time. We have been blessed. Every now and then we'll have something happen in our churches across this country, but very rare does it happen. We could stand here on this stage tonight and we could proclaim the Word of God freely. I could stand on a stage in Branson, Missouri, the live entertainment capital of the world, and I don't have to worry about my life because of the sacrifices that have been made. So we got to talking about that, and that led us to another conversation about a sacrifice that was made some 2,000 years ago on an old rugged cross. A sacrifice that was made so that we could have freedom from this thing called sin. We got home after having that conversation. Dina says, I've got this song for the show. And it's this song right here, written by a friend of ours by the name of Christy Sutherland. I want you to listen to the words of a song that says, Somebody Died for Me.
He was a troubled kid in and out of jail, until his daddy said, this is the last time I'll pay bail. So he enlisted in the army and they sent him to Iraq. He was a different man when he came back. Somebody said the army must have whipped you into shape, but he said that's not the reason that I changed. Somebody died for me before I even asked for help. Gave his life for me when I couldn't save Now they fold the flag and attach a silver star. As the grieving mother leans against his arm, and then he stands before the family and he does his best to tell how he survived the night his best friend fell. He said no one who knew him was surprised he died that way. He tried to live for Jesus, and he always used to say that somebody died for me before I even asked for help. He gave his life for me when I couldn't save myself. I cannot live the way I live or be the way I was. Every day is a gift to me. Somebody died for me before I even asked for help. He gave his life for me when I couldn't save myself. I cannot live the way I live, be the way I was. Every day's a gift to me because somebody died.
Somebody died for me. May we never forget who that was. Last night we talked about the fact that we are no longer, those of us who know Jesus Christ as our personal Savior, are no longer our own. The Scripture tells us that we have been bought, and we have been bought with a price, and that price was the death on that old rugged cross some 2,000 years ago. Tonight's one of those messages that could very easily get me in trouble. If I were to put a title to this message, it would be this. Know your role. Now, if you've known sports, that is, before that, and not in a church, we would say, shut up and know your role. And not sure we should say that, but I will tell you this. I think it is very important that each and every one of us knows our role in the body of Christ. Because when we get out of sorts with what our role is when problems begin to surface. So I just want to walk us through. Tomorrow morning, if you don't have a place to be, we'd love for you to be here. I'm going to preach a message that says this: a call of salvation is a call to service. But before we get into the topic tonight, I just want you to think about knowing your particular role in your life and in your church family and in your home and in your marital relationships. There, you know, the Bible has very plainly staked out some things that we are to do and to be a part of. I'm a firm believer beyond a shadow of a doubt, and this is where I say it can get you in trouble in a lot of places, but I firmly believe that the husband is to be the head of the household. That is his role. Unfortunately, I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt in American churches that the man has kind of dropped the ball on that. Not that women can't do things, but Boy, the women have had to pick up a lot of slack for a whole lot of men that did a lot of nothing. My daughter is 21 years old, and she cracks me up sometimes, but I think she grasped this concept. She's in Mississippi College down in Mississippi, and I was giving her a hard time about dating. She's never dated. And her and I have had a long conversation. She said, "Dad, I don't want to date." She said, "I want to just fall for that guy." I said, "Well, good luck. I hope it works for you." But one of the things she said was, I was talking to her about a guy that she's kind of hanging out with or whatever. And I said, "Well, what about him? Seems to be a nice guy." And she goes, "Oh, no." And I said, "Well, what? What's wrong with him, Savannah?" She goes, "Oh, he's spiritually immature." And I said, "He's 19, for Pete's sakes. Give him a break." But I believe that the husband is to be the leader of the house. I believe that he is to be the spiritual leader of the house. And unfortunately, as I said, too many times the ladies have been the one who have taught. My son, in fact, came to know the Lord because of his grandmother, who took time to read Bible stories to him and to sing songs with him so that he came to a saving knowledge of Christ. And we could go into different categories and different things, the husband and the wife and the children obey and all of that. But I want to look as an overall picture of something that I think we really need to consider. And this may be one of those messages that has one point, and it could be over in probably 3 minutes. But let me just tell you this. I believe if you ask someone to give their opinion of themselves, it would probably be a lot higher than if you ask their friends. That's the society we live in. We think we do no wrong. We think that we are somebody or something. And that can get you in trouble when you're looking at your role in what God has for you in your life. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, let's look at the scripture. Romans chapter 12, where we were at last night. Romans chapter 12, verse number 3. You know, we talked last night, "I beseech you therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable unto God, which is your reasonable service. And be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you may prove what is that good and acceptable and perfect will of God." Verse number 3 says this, "For I say, through the grace given unto me, to every man that is among you, not to think of himself more highly than he ought to think, but to think soberly, according as God hath dealt to every man the measure of faith." Dear Heavenly Father, I pray that you'll allow me to move aside your words to speak clearly and plainly tonight, so that we can walk out of here having a better idea of what our role should be in your purpose for us here on earth. I ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. First thing I want to look about, the scripture says, is to not think more highly of yourself. In other words, I've been accused of this my entire life. It hurts me, but it is something I've had to work on. And that is, I have been told that I have a tendency to be very arrogant. There was no shock in that at all. I was hoping somebody would say, "Nah, that ain't going to happen." I have always been that way. I've always said that. I have a friend of mine who, he wants to get under my skin. He'll just say, "Hey, you're becoming arrogant." I'm like, "Really?" And I have to take a step back. Think more highly of yourself. Think soberly. And here's the thing. The passage of Scripture says that God has given to us what we are to be. The faith that we are to have doesn't come from it. It's from Him. So our role that we are to play in God's greater plan is several things. And there are some things that I can tell you that we are all called to do, and we will get into that a little bit more tomorrow. But I think it's important that we understand that as the passage of Scripture in Romans 12, if you continue to read, goes on to say that, you know what, we are all part of one body. We are all a part of the body of Christ, but we do not all have the same purpose and the same office as somebody else. And we get in trouble when we begin to step out of our role of what God has given us into someone else's role. One of the biggest things, I think, beyond a shadow of doubt, once again, some of you will be prepared for this. Listen, I really, really struggle with people telling a pastor what should go on in church. Do you realize that the man of God, in fact, I'll tell you how much I believe this. I got fired from a church because I believe this so strongly. I believe beyond a shadow of a doubt that the person that is to stand and answer for this church and what it does is not you. It is the under-shepherd, and that is the pastor. You want to know when church is getting problem, when churches run into problems? When people try to tell the preacher what to preach. When they try to tell him that, oh, we need to do this, we need to do that. Listen, if you don't have enough faith and trust in your pastor that he's talking to God and know what is going on, then you need to find you a new pastor or you need to find a new church. See, I told you, Brother Jim's squirming already. I can say it. He may never invite me back. But there are certain roles. But you know, there are so many things that we tend to step out of bounds on. I had growing up, I'll never forget this. My dad, and he's told this story many times. We had a family join our church, and there were about 13 of them in there. And they joined the church. And my dad is a strong King James Bible guy, but he is not one of these that just beats you over the head with it. That's just what he does. And I'll never forget that the gentleman that was the head of this family that all 13 of them moved in. And boy, man, Brother Jim, they played every instrument you could think of. They could sing. They jumped right in. They were a part of everything. And about 2 months into them being in our church, they came to my dad and said, if you don't preach King James only in the next 4 weeks, we're gone. And my dad says, see ya. You don't do that. That's not your role. That is not your role. You say, no, listen, it's not your role. But I'll tell you what your role is. Your role, every single one of us in here, is to pray for the ministry of this church. Every one of us in here has the ministry to get down on your knees on a Saturday night before the service on Sunday and to pray that God's Spirit moves. You think Brother Jim's doing something wrong? Pray. I guarantee you God will let him know. But something's supposed to do, and just do that. Every single one of us has a role. Don't think too highly of yourself, because here's the deal, and this is not a slam in any way, shape, or form. Your role may be to come here and to empty trash cans. Your role may be to come here and vacuum the church. Your role may be to stand at that door and to welcome each and every person that comes in. Your role may be to visit the sick. See, God has given all of us abilities and talents. And not them all the same. But you know what? If the body doesn't have every part working together, what do we call that? In the human body, if something is not working, what do we call that? Sick. And if your church body is not working together, then your church body is sick. So you say, well, what do we do? I'll tell you what we do. We get on our face before God and say, what is my purpose here? What is my purpose in this church? And here's the thing. When you try to do something that you are not equipped to do and God has not given you the ability to do, you will foul it up every time. If I were to stand at this keyboard and try to do exactly what he does, it would not be pretty. I took 7 years of piano, and this is what I got. I think I've got it. Or you got it turned down, don't you? Here you go. 7 years of piano lessons right there. Now, if I could just do that, that'd be a horrible song service, wouldn't it? But boy, Lee gets up here and he starts to play it, and boy, it sounds like melodic music, and we can sing and get involved. I can't do that. Why? God hadn't given me that ability. So many of us are trying to do things that is not what God has given us the ability to do. And then there's some of us, like the story tells us, that have done something totally different with their talent, and that is you've just sat on it. There may be somebody in here who is great at decorating, but you've never offered to do anything for the cause of Christ in that way. There may be some of you who, I've been saved a long, long time, and I've come and I have sat, and my duty is to fill that pew and that seat. That's it. That's what I'm there to do. I don't think that's right. I think probably you're a big toe that's causing us to be off balance because you're not doing what God told you to do. I said there's so many of us last night, I said there's so many of us who are trying to live a Christian life, forgetting the fact that we belong to Him. And so when He comes to us and says, hey, do this. Nah, I ain't doing that. Hey, go to so-and-so and tell him you're praying for him. Drop off a pie at somebody's house. We had a lady in my church growing up, Mrs. Shirley, that, boy, she made the best cinnamon rolls. I mean, they were unbelievable homemade cinnamon rolls. I loved when we got cinnamon rolls from Miss Shirley because you know what? She can bake. She could do that. Her only problem was is that she didn't know what time it was in each day. And so when she got done with the cinnamon rolls at 2 in the morning, she called my dad up and said, hey, the cinnamon rolls are ready. Come get them. I'm thankful I was a kid because when I woke up at 7, they were there. Now, she could bake. There was another lady in our church, and I won't give you her name, but if she cooked, everybody avoided that plate. It was off to the side. She didn't have that gift. She didn't have that ability. And this may be simple, folks, but I think it's really understandable. Really, really something we need to understand when we begin to think about being servants one to another. And servants for the cause of Christ is to know exactly what we should be doing. And there's a whole series of things you could go through, and I don't have time to expound on all of them, but there have been gifts that have been given to each and every one of you. When I was working in Young Marys, one of the first things we did in our church was we took a new married couple, and we would go through, and they came to our church, and we would put them through this class so that they could discern what their gift was. Because, listen, if you don't have patience, you don't need to be working with kids. You're liable to yell at them. You're liable to scream. You're liable to end up with a lawsuit. So we had to weed those out. Hey, this is not your ministry. When I was in Bible college, Cherry Street Baptist Church in Springfield, Missouri, Doc Bolin, he was one of my professors at college, and I said, Doc, I said, what do you do when you go to a church and you want somebody to sing in your choir? They want to sing in your choir, and they can't sing a lick. What do you do? He said, I learned a long time ago, this is what you do. You go to them quietly, and you go to them and say, listen, God has given you a gift. This is not it. I will help you find it. Now, the problem we have in most church bodies today is not necessarily people doing the wrong gifts or the wrong part. It's the fact that nobody's doing anything. And when you drop the ball and you don't do your part, you cause things to not run smoothly. I'm often wondered in my life if God hasn't given me certain things because I wasn't ready to handle it. You say, well, God has allowed us to see growth in our church. That's great. I love it. Before you take the next step, maybe some of you need to start doing something. Be servants to the ministry here. And then begin to pray that God calls servants out of this church to go other places. And then to support someone who may go around the world on missions. But you got to have everything together. You got to understand what your part is. And be honest with you, like I said, I think the biggest struggle in most churches is people have the talent right there to do it, but they won't commit to do it. And when you don't commit, that means somebody else has to take up for it, and usually somebody that doesn't have the skill to do it. I got in trouble one time making this statement and saying the fact that this, I believe that everything, Brother Jim, everything this church needs to have an impact on this town is in this building. You just have to do it. You have to decide to do it. Romans chapter 12, it says this. It says, for not to think highly of ourselves, to think soberly, because God has given us a measure of faith. For as we have many members in one body, and all members have not the same office, so we being many are one body in Christ, and every one members one of another. Having the gifts different according to the grace that is given to us. The grace, remember the grace. God bestows grace upon us. He has given us the grace to do the things we need to do. Will you do it? Will you be the one that picks up? Listen, I know you. Some of you ladies can sit and talk on the phone for hours. My wife does. She talks to her kids 17 times a day. It's annoying. No, not really. I love to hear her talking to her kids, but she'll do that. Some of you ladies spend a lot of time talking on the phone. Now, here's the question I want to ask you. How much of the time you spend talking on the phone do you talk about the things of God and the things of this church? Or are you too busy talking about other things? And I'm not talking about gossip, okay? That's a whole different message. You know, the old telephone game, one starts talking, all that. I'm talking about how many times do you say, hey, you know what we got going on in the church? Somebody that doesn't even go here, man, do you not know we have revival going on in our church? Man, if you got a free time, come on over, man. That's all that it takes for somebody to come. It's for you to offer. How many of you have done it? Don't raise your hands. How many of you have done that this week? I know this has been planned for a while. How many of you said, hey, on the phone, by the way, hey, if you get a chance, we'd love to have you. You know what? Hey, I'll buy you a Coke afterwards. I'll take you to dinner. Come to Sunday service. Hey, when we get done with church, after Brother Jim gets done and closes, we're going to go out to eat, and I'll buy your dinner. Some of you saying, I ain't buying nobody's dinner. Why not? That's a sacrifice, being a servant to somebody for the cause of Christ. I'm amazed. I'm amazed when you go into so many churches, and we do. Oh, I could tell you story after story of churches that when we walk into, one thinks so highly of themselves that they don't really want you there. Two, how do I say this? Lord, give me the words. They don't want to see God's kingdom grow. You say, nobody that comes to church believes that. Oh, yeah? I've known preachers who, when somebody comes to them and says, hey, we need to go start this, or we need to go to this neighborhood, and we need to win people to Christ, the preacher goes, I don't know. We don't know that we want them in here. Church I pastored in Pine Bluff, Arkansas. When I started pastoring there, I was 23 years old. I was dumb. They were dumb for hiring me. 23 years old. Do you know in the church minutes in Pine Bluff, Arkansas, to the day I was pastoring, and this was in 2000, said that they could not set an African-American in their church building. And when I brought that up, Brother Jim, I had some men say, well, why would we want them here? There are people like that. There are people like that that live that life. That's not being a servant. That's not saying, hey, you know what? The Bible says, for all have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. John 3:16 said he gave his life for the whole world. Those little things. You say, well, I don't carry that chip on my shoulder. No, but you may carry something on with you when you walk in. Boy, that family, I've known that family for years. There's nothing good that comes out of that family. Our former pastor that married us is Hosey Ballou. I don't know if any of you know Hosey Ballou or not. Hosey pastored Ridgecrest Baptist Church, and the Ballou family is a huge family. I will tell you that, but they've broken themselves up into two corners. You've got the preachers, and you've got the rebels. And so whenever I meet a Ballou, that's the first question I ask them. And you know what, Brother Jim? They answer. They go, "Yep, I'm one of them preachers," or "No, I'm a rebel." But I think it's important that we realize that we need to know our role and how we are to do our things. And here's the one of the things that I can express to you that how you can understand what your position and your role is in this place. And that is, take time to get on your knees and say this: I'm willing to do whatever you want me to do. I'm willing to run that vacuum cleaner. I'm willing to drive my car and pick up somebody to come to church. I'm willing to drop an extra $20 in the plate so that we can have a missionary do something. I'm willing to do those things. And you know what you'll be surprised is that before long on your knees, God will have given you something in your heart and your mind, and you'll know exactly where to go. One of the things I learned early on in my ministry is that if somebody comes to you, and I don't know, Brother Jim, if this happened to you, somebody says, well, Brother Edwards, we really need to do this. Well, the Lord's laid that on your heart, has he? Yes, he has laid that on our heart. Then, man, I will support you and you get after it. Well, oh, I didn't mean that. I mean, you need to do it. No, Lord didn't lay that on my heart. He laid that on your heart. Boy, before long, you start getting on your knees, you'll realize God's pointing you in a certain direction. And you want the body to work smoothly and to run smoothly. Boy, you begin to see some things pop. Boy, things need to happen. Why? Because God's speaking to you, telling you what to do. He's showing you. You say, well, I don't know about that. Let me end with this thought right here. We talk about being a servant. The first thing in order for you to be a servant of God is, one, as we mentioned last night, you need to understand that you're not your own. And second of all, you need to find your place, and you need to raise your hand. As Isaiah said, here am I, send me. Know your role. And I can tell you beyond a shadow of a doubt, if you're a member of this place, God has a purpose for you. It may be to hand candy out to people. My home church, we had a man, he was a big old Russian, straight from Russia. I love to hear Brother Bechtel preach. Boy, pray. He prayed the glory down. But you know what he was known for as our church? He was the candy man. And every child that came into church, he gave a little piece of candy. That was his ministry. Had another lady in a church that all she did was write thank you cards. That was what she was good at. We had another lady in our church that did that nice, beautiful calligraphy, you know, that fancy writing and stuff. And she would do everything we needed for a deal. I mean, she didn't do anything else. That was what she did. That was her. You knew at that time of year you were going to go to her and she was going to do it. That was her plan. That was what she had given to her by God, her gift, and she decided to use it. So let's find out where God has given you the ability to do what he has given you to do, and then get after it. Because it may be, this is often said in our RV, you may have one job. You may have one job. One. But boy, could it ever be a big job. Do you realize that I could tell you story after story after story of people who have picked up on a bus some of the greatest preachers in the world, who came out of poverty, who came out of a life that you say they'll never amount to anything, but boy, somebody loved them, somebody cared for them, somebody picked them up, brought them to church, they accepted Christ. And you know what? They've seen thousands come to know the Lord through them because somebody did their one job, which may in most people's minds seem to be a humble, lowly thing, but in the end, it had great impact for the cause of Christ and his kingdom forever and ever and ever. No, we are bought with a price and we are no longer his. And we need to be willing to take the gift God has given us and do something with it. Dear Heavenly Father, I thank you for the opportunity today to be in your house. I thank you for the truth found in your word. And Lord, I thank you that you've built it in such a way that we can have a part, what an honor for us to have a part in your ministry, to see others come to know the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ. Maybe because, boy, I just did that one little thing. Lord, help us to know what our part is and not to overstep our bounds to fit in your will. Lord, help us to have the heart of a servant. The example of you, that you left your throne in heaven to die for us. Equal with God, yet lowered yourself to come to save us. Oh, Lord, may we take the example of you and live it out in our life. We ask these things in your precious and holy name. Amen. Stand with your heads bowed and your eyes closed for just a moment. Maybe some of you just need to come to this old-fashioned altar and say, I'm willing. Maybe that's where it starts. Maybe you just need to say, okay, Lord, what do you want me to do? I'm willing. Maybe others of you know what God has called you to do, and maybe you just need to say, I'm going to do it. I'm willing. The quietness of this hour, let Him speak to you. Don't resist what God's leading you to do. Don't fight it. You will be unhappy and miserable trying to live outside of God's will. Just say, I'm willing. I'm willing to be a servant. I'm willing to do whatever you would have me to do. You come this time.
Something for me. You can do it easily, I guarantee you. Here's the deal. I heard a story one time, and while Jonathan was preaching, it came to me. A church, good-sized church with a whole lot of young boys, all of them one meaner than the next. They were rotten. They could not keep a Sunday school teacher. These boys just made life miserable for them. Had an old farmer who didn't know anything about teaching. He couldn't. Finally, the Lord dealt with him until he said, I can deal with them boys, and I know the gospel. The preacher puts him in a class. He taught what little he knew, which was not much, and he managed to ride herd on all these little boys. One of those boys, Jonathan's name was Billy Sunday. Anybody here who knows preachers, Billy Sunday saw thousands upon thousands upon thousands saved. He was as good a preacher as ever walked on this planet. Because one guy who had no ability stopped and said, I'll ride herd on him. I'll teach him what little I know. Did he need what that man knew? He needed salvation. And then God provided. What I'm going to ask Lee to do, hit one note of that for me. Just one note of it. Hit a different note. Hit a different one. Now hit all three of them together. Boy, that's, whoo. Folks, that's a dysfunctional church. Now start playing the song again. That function. That's a saint. Let me check this out. Woo. That's the same bunch of keys.
Yep.
Wow. The same bunch of keys. They all white and black. They all sitting in the same spot. But when they're hit in the right order, they turn into something that sounds like that. Whenever I play that thing, hey, he's heard me. He knows me well. But when Lee plays that thing, don't think more highly of yourself than you. When Lee plays that thing, he's something. Folks, I want to sum up the sermon. That's a great sermon, and I may not ask you back because they may not have me back. But, folks, what is your part? I don't want to do your part. Nobody here ever tells me what to preach. I think they would all, every once in a while through the years, Charlotte has stopped and said, "You would not believe what so-and-so said." And I said, "No idea. They want me to tell you to preach on this." And I said, "What'd you say?" And she said, "He ain't gonna listen to me." I don't want nobody to tell me what to preach on, but I don't want to tell you guys what to do either. All my job is as under-shepherd, that's a good word, my job is to try to organize it all and make it into something that sounds like that. Because all of us are one separate note, including me. But boy, you know, we have a God that can take all them notes, and when He begins to play them, they sound amazing. Just be your note. Find your place and be part of that. That's how a church grows. We all join in together. Amen?
Amen.
Hit mine again. There we go. I like that. Every head bowed, every eye closed. Lord, I just thank you so much right now that you do have a plan. You have a note for each one of us. You have a part for each of us to be. Lord, I just ask that we each surrender to you. What do you need me to do? And starting with me, Lord, let me know what you need me to do. I just thank you so much that you do have a bigger plan than I can ever come up with or anybody else in here could ever come up with. I thank you right now for the message, for the music. I thank you for the open hearts and ears and minds. But I thank you most of all for your Son, Jesus Christ. Without Him, none of this is worth our time. We ask right now that you be with our time of fellowship, that you go with each one of us as we leave this place. Bring us back together safely. In Jesus' precious name we pray. And the whole crowd say it.
Amen.
Amen.